my lords and my lady. I'm sure you'll have questions for me, but may I make a statement before you do?
Of course.
Yes. Well, I would like to start with an absolute unreserved apology for the inadvertent early disclosure of the summary of the judgment in this case. An apology on my own behalf, on behalf of Mr. Greaves, and on behalf of my chambers, who's chief executive and senior practice director and marketing director in court today. Ms. Dunning from the Welsh Assembly Government Legal Service has very kindly come to court today, leaving Cardiff at crack of dawn, but it is she is not part of the mistakes that happened here, so she's here to observe. It is a mistake that arose through my action and the Chamber's action. You will have seen the letter which I sent to court with Mr. Greaves on Monday, and the four accompanying witness statements, and I hope that from those documents you can accept the following propositions. Firstly, that unlike in the recent Supreme Court case of Crossland, their disclosure was not deliberate. Secondly, that it was the result of a series of small mistakes and misunderstandings in a system intended to ensure timely distribution of the substance of a judgment, no early disclosure, but the mistakes in that system cumulative led to one serious error. Thirdly, the error was corrected as quickly and completely as possible within a very short space of time, a matter of a couple of minutes after it was brought to our attention. Fourthly, that we all recognised the gravity of the mistake and took immediate steps to do three things. First, and so far as I was concerned, the first priority, to notify the court and opposing representatives of the accidental disclosure of the gist of the judgment. Secondly, to offer an immediate apology for that mistake. And thirdly, to come to court at the court's earliest convenience to apologise in person, as we are now doing. The fact that the initial apology came from Matrix and was signed by my senior practice director was intended to communicate the fact of the breach to the court as soon as possible, and to reflect all our understanding that it was a series of mistakes and misunderstandings by a number of individuals, including myself and Mr. Greaves, which led to the disclosure, and that the chambers as a whole, as well as the individuals within it, recognised and regretted the seriousness of these cumulative errors. The sixth point is that it was a one-off error. It hasn't occurred in any other case involving Mr. Greaves or myself, in my case at 30 years at the bar, and it has not, to the best of my knowledge, information or belief, occurred to anyone else in my chambers before this. The seventh point is that the mistake ought not to have occurred within the rigorous protocols sharing the fact of forthcoming judgments, but not their content, internally for administrative purposes and only on a strict need-to-know basis, but it did happen. And that's the eighth point, that this mistake did happen as a result of three human errors, and notwithstanding that, there was such a system. On the evening of the breach, and again on the next day, extensive and immediate steps were taken by myself senior people in my chambers to reconsider, refine and improve chambers procedures with immediate effect, so as to minimise and one hopes to eliminate the prospect of any recurrence of the error. And finally, although this is perhaps no more than a fortuitous footnote, in practical terms, the breach did not lead to any significant further disclosure in the national media or elsewhere on social media, so far as we can ascertain. We haven't found it retweeted anywhere else. And there were 43 views on our chambers website, including, I must say, a number of anxious views by myself and my junior and instructors.
Well, Ms. Manfield, the problem is, I understand that there are 14,000 followers of your chambers on Twitter and 7,500 followers of your chambers on LinkedIn, which means that 21,000 people had this flash up on their feed. And whether they read it or not, we'll never know. But
yes.
This is not an incidental breach, is it?
My Lord, I don't pay much emphasis on that, and I don't for a moment suggest that it is. And my Lord, in your letter on the 11th of February, you said correctly that I would be familiar with the practice direction 14E in the CPR, And of course it is right, I hope, that I have always understood, or at least sought to abide by, the spirit and purpose of that practice direction in maintaining the confidentiality of a court's decision until the court itself has spoken once and in public. And I'm aware of the problems that have arisen in cases like Binyam Mohammed as a result of mistakes in that respect.
I mean, the problem is that the mistakes really mounted up, because obviously both you and Mr. Greaves failed to understand or see or read two emails about a very sensitive question, namely a judgment under embargo. But there were people in your office, more than one person, who could have had access to the judgment, who really didn't need to, because the purpose for which there was a discussion about the judgment shouldn't have been happening at all, should it?
And my lord, that is what the next point I wanted to make, because having said I was aware of practice direction, of course, the unfortunate situation that's arisen now has led me to examine that practice direction and paragraph 2.4 in particular with more forensic rigour than I perhaps had given it before. I should have done, and I'm sorry that I didn't, but I thought I understood the spirit of it, and so I've looked carefully at the language. And you will see from Ms. Bausch's witness statement, and be aware, that the draft judgment was not sent directly to Mr. Greaves or myself, but to our clerking team.
Well, that is the normal practice.
Well, yes, it is. Yes, it's common practice amongst court administrative staff. In some courts, particularly before the pandemic, it had become more usual for judgments to be sent directly to counsel, but it is the normal practice, my lord. And Ms. Bauscher has explained that it was she who telephoned your clerk, not me or Mr. Greaves, and perhaps it should have been me or Mr. Greaves. It was she who telephoned to access the password, was given the password, and used it to accept.
Well, that link was opened. It's the least objectionable thing that happened in this process. She quite properly fed in the password to make sure it worked, closed it up again, and sent it on to you and Mr. Greaves, which is absolutely fine.
Yes.
The problem is that there was any discussion about the judgment for the purposes of issuing a Chambers press release.
Yes, my lord.
And can I just draw attention to the fact that in the case of Crossland,
yes, my lord,
which is the reason I referred you to this,
yes,
at paragraph 63,
yes,
the appeal panel says that there are three purposes of handing down a judgment in draft, and they are specifically enabling the parties to make suggestions for the correction of errors, preparing submissions on consequential matters, and to prepare themselves for the publication of the judgment. By themselves is meant the party,
yes,
not representatives of the party.
And my lord, that's why I offer an unreserved apology, because
your apology, Miss Manfred, you please, we're not here undertaking contempt proceedings.
No.
And we could be.
Yes.
And I intend to make clear in the judgment that I'm going to give later this morning that next time there will be contempt proceedings,
yes,
whoever breaches the embargo. But we're not in that position today, and your apology is accepted. Of course, there was, as you have rightly said, no deliberate intention to break the embargo. But the process that was followed was anyway, in my provisional view at the moment, flawed.
Yes.
Because what you were doing was preparing for issuing a press release for your chambers, which is nothing to do with the reason why an embargo judgment is handed down.
Yes.
And we must restrict. If you'd wanted to do that, now you understand what the practice direction means, you would have had to apply to the judge, to the court, and say, may we use the embargo judgment to prepare a press release for our chamber's website? And the answer, with the benefit of hindsight, would have been no.
Yes.
And it'll be now clear from the judgment that I do intend to give shortly, that the answer would be no. But the point is, that's what went wrong.
Yes, my lord, and that's why that evening we recognised that that is what had gone wrong, that we had interpreted internal and administrative too broadly, that that was a mistake, on my part principally, but it was a procedure to make sure that it went up within minutes of the judgment. We shouldn't have done it, and we have changed that procedure to make it clear that it can't happen again.
Which I'm pleased to hear. I don't think that your new procedure, whilst I welcome it, is relevant for analysis by the court.
No.
What I do intend to make clear in the judgment is what was wrong with what was happening before.
Yes, ma'am.
And I think that's going to help people understand that in the future, this embargo has to be taken more seriously. And let me just tell you, so you know, Miss Mountfield, the reason why I'm so particularly concerned about this is that this is not an isolated incident.
No.
This has happened, I won't say frequently, because that would be exaggerating, but it has happened on quite a number of occasions since I became Master of the Rolls, which is not that long ago, right, a year and a bit. And not in such a clear way so that something could be done and said, but happened nonetheless. And I think there is a laxity in the processes in chambers, where it was in your chambers, and I'm sure there are in some other chambers, which does need to be brought to attention. It's absolutely imperative, because otherwise the court will not have the trust and the confidence to hand down judgments in draft, and that's how we operate.
Yes.
I mean, is there any comment you want to make on any of that?
No, my lord. Just simply to hold my hands up to the mistakes that were made and to say that in the light of this, which is a very unfortunate incident, and you can see that on a database it's the 9th, somebody read it's the 8th, and I gave the statement to be handed down on the 9th too early, and that's my mistake, and I shouldn't have done it, and I apologise for not having read the practice direction with sufficient clearness, and I can only apologise for the accidental wider disclosure that occurred, and to say that for my part and for my chamber's part, valuable lessons have been learned, and I hope that...
Well, I hope they have, and the other thing that I think has to be understood is that you and your junior are obviously busy counsel, and you have great pressures on your time, and there is nothing wrong with that. But it indicates the importance of putting in place rigorous procedures with double checks, so that even if you're so busy that you can't read your emails, somebody is looking at the thing very closely and making sure that the embargo is respected.
Yes.
And that's the kind of process that Part 40, PD 40E envisages. And what I hope really every chambers and every solicitor's office will now look at very carefully. The problem is we're living in a different world, even from when PD 40E was introduced. We're living in a world of Twitter and LinkedIn, and the damage that can be done. I mean, in this case, even if 14,000 people knew a day early the outcome in this case, probably it's not going to be serious, but it could be serious. There could be market sensitive information, there could be all sorts of things that could flow from it, which could cause danger and injury to people in some cases.
And I really do appreciate that, my lord, and I think it was my insufficiently close reading of 2.4 of the practice direction that led to the problem, and also the fact that being counsel, I don't put a spin on a judgment, I merely announce the fact of it. But you're right that it could have, even if it was just without any spin or comment on the judgment, I wasn't a party with an axe to grind on it myself, I was just saying this is what happened, this is what's happening next, but it could still have been market
sensitive.
I do appreciate that.
Case about a child, it could be a case about the welfare of vulnerable people, it could be a case about very large sums of money and market sensitive information, which could cause all sorts I can't even imagine the consequences. I mean, I think people rarely understand, Ms. Mountfield, how much care this court takes to ensure that its judgments are kept confidential before they come out, because we we understand that they can be have very severe consequences for real people, which is what we're about, making sure that we are aware of what is likely to happen and when it's likely to happen.
Yes. Well, my Lord, that's why my apology is completely unreserved, and I recognise all those public policy reasons. I'm not, unlike in the Supreme Court case, trying to say yes, but there's different public policy reasons overrides that. I'm just saying I'm sorry, it was a mistake with busy people.
Yeah. No, the Supreme Court case was only referred to for that very simple exposition, which seemed to me to encapsulate why we hand down embargo judgments in the most part.
Yes.
The article about Binyan Mohammed was very interesting, I thought, but quite irrelevant, really, to the situation here, save to know that in Canada they don't hand down judgments in draft at all.
And in the first Miller case in which I was involved, they didn't hand down a judgment in draft either for that reason.
No. Well, I mean, that's another example of where there have been issues in very high-profile cases. I mean, I'm not talking about Miller, but it's a problem, and it's one that I hope the judgment I'm going to give shortly will clear up. And it's not intended, just so that you know, it's not intended to be making an example of anybody. If we'd wanted to do that, we would have been having contempt proceedings. But it's intended to make absolutely clear to the profession, when I give this judgment, that there must be better procedures in place. That's the point.
I am grateful, my Lord, for recognising the lack of intention to flout any rule or policy of the court and the practice directions.
Right. Well, what I intend to do, unless you've got anything else you want to say, is to rise now. I shall deliver an oral judgment, which will, I think, will say start at 10:45.
Thank you.
Okay. Court rise. G'day, Ross Scott. How you going? You all right? All right, just quickly. Do you want me to stop it and start it again? Well, they're not back to 10:45. Lovely, thanks, mate. Good on you. Cheers, Ross.